no worries. Firstly, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners, past and present, and also the NPA members, past and present, that have made this place what it is, and certainly the reason Liz and I decided to settle here. What I'm trying to convince you all of today is that biodiversity is the best measure of ecosystem health, and that every species matters. And if that's the message you take home today, then this has been a huge victory. There's a lot of talk at the moment, and on the drive in here, some of you may have even been here because of that. They were talking about the netters on North Shore and how we need to close them down. I'm going to try not to talk about that until the very end if we can. What I'd like you to think about, though, is everyone with all these voices and opinions they're putting forth, they've all got their vested interests and various backgrounds that may or may not be full of truthful information. So in all this argument, I'd like you just to consider who's telling you what they're telling you and what their bias and their real agenda is all about. So of course, I've got one too. Mine is more species of fish, more of them, and clearer water so I can film the bloody things. But hopefully that's in the general best interest of the river and all of you folks as well, and fishermen. So where I came from, I grew up in Amberley and Logan, so southeast Queensland. Every weekend and holiday was camping, fishing, just like everyone around here does. So the exact same growing up as what local kids here have got. My family's from North Queensland as well, so I used to do longer holidays up in Cardwell. So there's mangroves, seagrass, crocodiles, the rest of the Queensland coast. At 16, I left the Great Southeast to go to uni in Townsville. So basically, I spent the next big chunk of time up there. I studied marine biology. And realised there that if you want to know just about what enzyme makes something tick, you need to be in a lab full of other scientists. But if you want to understand what the entire underwater world is all about, you need to spend time underwater and just watch. So the only way to do that cost effectively is to become a dive instructor. And while there's other people around looking at things and kicking up the bottom, you can actually just observe what's going on. You very quickly find the best way to do that is on liverboards. And a liverboard, for the uninitiated, is a dive boat who pulls up in the morning at the best site that location has to offer. So you wake up, you step into your dive gear and you plop over into the best that this area has. You get up and have a cooked breakfast, you get back in, do another dive. Get out, have a cooked lunch, get back in, do another dive. Get out, have fresh cookies, get back in, do another dive. Have dinner, go for another dive, and then go to bed by 8:30 usually, because you're buggered. Then you get up the next morning, the boat's moved to another fantastic location, you do the whole thing again. So that is a good way to not only see the best the world has to offer, but rack up a lot of hours underwater. So that's where all the dives came from. While you're doing all that, it's a full-time job, 24/7. So you can rack up all this footage, but you don't have time to do anything with it. So Liz and I decided in 2007 we needed to get off boats and get on land so that we could catalog and put all this footage to some use. We decided this is as good a place as any in the world to settle. So that's why we're here now, but we still travel abroad to do a lot of our filming. We put together DVDs now, short films. My real life's work, though, is the species documented. So biodiversity is what matters, and I've got over 2,900 species so far. All of those are donated online to EOL, which is the modern version of Encyclopedia Britannica. So if you care about any species, you want to look it up, you look there. If I've got footage of it, you can see it. So that's a nice thing for the world. So here's where we've been: California, Bahamas, Mexico, Galapagos, Palau, and then a heap of stuff close to home. This is Indonesia, PNG, Solomons, Vanuatu, New Caledonia, Tonga, and Fiji, whole East Coast, and Rolly Shoals. We've done some local stuff. I'm not going to worry about this now, but if you're interested, have a look on our YouTube channel. There's some local films that we've put together over the years since we've been here. And this is our website where you can find this. Now, this isn't all about just plugging ourselves. This is because hopefully at the end of today, you'll have some interest in at least one of these species, and this is where you can go to find out more and do more with it. So on this page, underseaproductions.com, look for the Noosa River page, which I'll show you in a second. But up here in the search box is where you want to put in the word Noosa, and you'll see every shot that I've got from Noosa. This is the Noosa page that I was just alluding to. It's the video for those of you that were here last time I did a talk. This was the highlight reel that you saw then. It's from the first 18 odd dives. There's a little spiel there and contact information. So if you want to follow up today, that's where you do it. And here's how it all works. So every time we drag this dirty big thing around with us, every time you press start, stop, because you're shooting a fish, that's a clip. And when you get 20 or 30 odd thousand of those things, they're completely useless unless you've got them catalogued. So a very dear friend of ours, Doug Smith, the California guy, designed this database for us where we can put in all the species information. It collects all the camera information, including the creation date or when it was shot. And then I can put in all these keywords. And that feeds into our website so that when you put in the word Noosa up the top there, you get all the clips that we've shot of Noosa. So this is free for anybody who is interested in seeing what's underwater at Noosa. You do that and you'll get all these. And if this was a real website, you could hover over these and the videos would play. But if you want to see them bigger, say you're interested in this guy, for example, you click on it, you see the video, and you get, importantly, all this information here. So far you've just known Noosa and you've just seen an interesting looking fish. But when you click on that, now you know that it's called Erythron manilensis, or the striped puffer. It's in the Tetrodontidae family. It was filmed on the 29th of October in the Noosa River. And all of those things are links. So you may decide that this is actually probably an important species that you'd like to make a short film to show your classmates or your fishing club. So what you would need to do is make a sequence, look for the other stuff that was shot on that date. So click on that. Now we're doing a search for that. And that's basically, this is the whole dive that I did on that date. So you can see the shot that we just looked at, some wider close-up feeding, some spooge they're feeding on, all kinds of different stuff. Click the shots you want, you get this download button and you get this pop-up. I know I'm rushing through this and most of you will never do this, but for the one person in the room that does, follow me here. So you click this little button and you get this, do you want to download this thing off the internet? And you say, yes, save it to my computer. And then you end up with these five short films that have cost you absolutely nothing, clips. They're watermarked with our name and they're compressed so they don't look very good, but they're free, so what do you want? You can download them all like this and they'll show up on your desktop. And from there, you can use any video editing software to put them in some sort of order that shows a story. You could narrate over the top. You've just been to Wikipedia, so you've searched the species, you know all about them. Do a quick narration, some titles, bit of music. Bob's your mum's brother. We've got a short film that shows why this species matters. So that's the big picture that anybody can do. This stuff is free, it's online, and it's available today. So why are you all still sitting here? Okay, because you want to know about fish. So my mission in life is to make Liz happy. For those, any young fellas here, that's the take-home message, happy wife, happy life. To film every species of fish in the Indo-Pacific, and there's about 2,500 of them. We've got about 1,300 so far, and I'll get to that in a second of what that area actually is. Make a short film about each one explaining why it matters. So that's what I've just explained how to do. More locally, to film and understand every phase of life of every species. So it's not enough just to say, well, this is a mangrove jack eating a lure, and that's what it looks like. But we need to know that this is a mangrove jack when it's this big, it's way up in the Everglades. When it's this big, it's in the seagrass. When it's this big, it moves down to lower estuary. And when it's this big, it spawns at the mouth. That would be a film that would be worth showing. And then it would have some value for fisheries management and all that kind of stuff. So that's the big picture there. It's also every species, not just fish. So we need to know about seagrass, mangroves, sponges, everything. To raise river life awareness, the nuisance and visitors, that's why I'm here. To create a sustainable ongoing fishing line removal program, and by sustainable I mean funded. Support and create underwater documentary filmmakers here in Noosa, and to contribute to a future where the other 70% of the planet is understood and respected. Most people look at that out there and go, oh, the water's nice and blue today, and don't give it a thought beyond that. And that's what I think we need to change. So today's lessons, Fish 101, going to run through at an incredibly ridiculous speed what biodiversity is and how it happened, what the river mouth looks like, why biodiversity matters, a few things that the or roles that our marine life are playing that you may not have considered, and any issues that I've found in my very limited research so far. So when we're talking about biodiversity, what are we talking about? This is at the end of Russell Street, at the deep, where the DPI tie up their boat. There's a mooring pontoon there. That's the pole that holds it up. And it's a cleaning station. So these are cleaner wrasses, a specialist species that clean parasites or fish. Then we've got all the snappers, the Moses perch, which are snappers, and you'll see a mangrove jack come out of this hole shortly. You've got surgeon fish, which are your herbivores. There's your mangrove jack. You've got little planktivores, damselfish down there eating plankton. And all of these things together is just the easy stuff that's easy to spot. We can see it. Down on the bottom here, we've got oysters and sponges and things doing a lot of filtering. We've got algae and spooge all over here. We've got little cardinal fish that live in caves during the day, and at night they will come out and be the planktivores. So all of this is what's making that little tiny system work. Whether it's working sustainably or long term, time will only tell. But they're the important players in that little spot. So we're talking about trevallies, of which so far there are seven species in the river, and I know for a fact there's more than that, I just haven't shot them yet. But these are the ones you're about to see. So the family of trevally is called Carangidae. So in the fish world, we call them carangids. The reason there's a problem with calling them trevallies is because they're not all trevallies, as you'll see, some of them are these. And if you're in America, they don't know what a trevally is. They call them all jacks. So carynx, carangids, these are the typical, when everyone says trevally, these are the three, four species. There's another one, ignobilis, that goes with these that everyone's talking about. The ones that are like carynx, but not quite, carangioides. So it's similar, but not quite. And then there's these three other genus that are nothing like these other ones. Most people don't even recognize them as trevallies. Some of them aren't even called trevally, but they are trevallies or carangids. Last thing on this one, our jacks that we call jacks, mangrove jack, Lugenus argentimaculatus, they're actually in the snapper family. But snappers, what everyone calls snappers on the east coast of Australia, are in the brim family. Why? They're actually a big brim. Yeah, the snappers I'm talking about, nobbies, they're also called. Knob on the head is a big one, squire is a little one. They're brims. If you think about them for a second in your mind, they look like a big brim. They are a big brim. That's the last of that. I'm way behind already. Okay, so carangids. So this is at the river mouth about a month ago. And this is a pretty typical mixed school about a month ago. These guys weren't here 6 months ago or any other time. And the groups you're seeing here is the kale-kale or kale-kale, whatever you call them, and the golden trevallies. So they're forming kind of a mixed school. We're going to run through each of the species here, and I'm going to talk about what's different about each one and why it matters that you can't just call them all trevally and expect to be talking about the same thing. So they'll form mixed schools because they're often feeding on the same thing. This is the one here in this shot, Malabaricus. I'm not even sure if that's a correct ID, but it's the only individual I've seen in the river so far, so he's probably not a big player. Melampygus, so this is, now we're in the typical trevally shape. So this is carynx. The blue fins, we see these on every coral reef all throughout the Indo-Pacific, everywhere, not in estuaries typically, which is why they're blue instead of yellow in their tail, so they blend out in the blue water. The juveniles of that species, they're following around this guy, which is a brim, and this guy, which is a silver biddy. And those two fish are feeding on the bottom, and they stir things up when that happens. And these juvenile trevally, you see him follow. Anywhere this guy goes, that one's going to follow, because he's got a better chance of catching a bit of a feed. This is the most common species. You see them every single dive on the rock wall, all year round so far that I've seen. I'm not 100% that species. It might be a juvenile giant trevally. But either way, they look really similar. This is another very closely related species, Carynx sexfasciatus. It's called a big eye trevally or big eye jack. And the reason it has a big eye and a black tail is because it's an open water, open ocean species. We'll be shooting this thing on a pristine coral reef next week in the middle of nowhere. So they're an open ocean species, so they're more visual predators, so the bigger eye. So that's the slight difference between the previous one and this one. They're probably feeding on the same things in the river, so maybe it doesn't matter. But these things, definitely different. These are the golden trevallies. Ignore the butterbream up here, but the big guys here are the goldens. Big fish, but still staying in a tight school because they know they're not that big in the world grand scheme of things. What's interesting about the goldens is different genus, so they're bottom feeders. They're not feeding on fish. They're groveling along the bottom. And when you see a school of them come through, they're like teenagers knocking bins over and everything. They just destroy the place. This is the juvenile. This is filmed 45 kilometres offshore a few years ago. And this is unusual. Most times we think of the juveniles as being in the estuaries, in the seagrass mangroves, and then the adults move offshore. But with this species, it's the opposite. So we've seen the big ones live inshore. These guys are also called pilot fish because they swim with sharks and mantas in the open ocean. That's why they're bright yellow, so they can attract other little bright yellow fish in the big blue, come together as a school around one of these big fish that's not moving, it should be, and then when they're ready to settle, they can settle as a school, bright yellow fish together. Amazing. Mental trevally, they call them kale-kale locally. Totally different body shape. You can see they've got this huge underslung jaw, so they're feeding on a different type of fish to what the carynx trevally are, most likely. I don't know. And then a completely different looking fish altogether, Seriola lalandi. They don't even call it a trevally, but it is in that same carangid family. And yellowtail amberjack is the most common name around these parts. So this is a whole pile of trevallies that the guys are saying, oh yeah, the fish are on trevallies, but which lure do you use for all trevallies? There's no such thing. This is the Coral Triangle. This is the centre of origin where basically all marine species that we know of in the tropics evolved. So they come out here, think of this as a factory spewing out species for millions of years. And as these species are spewing out of this, they're drifting off in all directions on the ocean's currents, north, south, east, west. And the only way those species can move is there's two ways. If they're a species that has a mobile adult, like a fish, they might migrate as adults and they might cover a bit more distance. But the majority of marine life doesn't. They have a mobile larval or dispersal stage where they release eggs or sperm or propagules or seed pods or whatever into the water. It drifts for as far as it can drift and then it settles. If it settles in a place it can live, it lives, grows to maturity, releases again, and generation by generation, they leapfrog their way over millions of years all the way in all directions till they hit their limits, whether it's too cold, too dirty, too hot, too whatever. So the result of that is high biodiversity here, less and less the further you go. But along the way, over the millions of years, doors get closed. So say, for example, this little patch here, that might have closed when the sea level rose or fell. So the species that have already come through will continue down and keep evolving, but that door's shut, so it's not getting fed the same spawn anymore. So these species here are evolving into new species, and that's what we see all over the Barrier Reef. You see species all the way along that have come here and are the same as these, that are still there today, but you also see all these others that are just a little bit different. They've got an extra stripe or an extra spot and extra teeth and extra whatevers, and that's because they've evolved with a different set of conditions to what the ones up here had. The important thing is that everything moves not nearly as far as what we once thought. So we used to say, oh, these things drift for 100 miles or 10,000 miles or whatever, and it doesn't matter. If you make a nice protected area here, that'll provide spawn for the rest of the Barrier Reef. And we now know that's not true. It's much smaller, so we need a lot closer marine protected areas if we're going to expect that the majority of species are actually still going to make that leapfrog. So if we look closer to home and closer to today, this is the bottom end of the Barrier Reef. Gladstone is about where it ends. At the moment, the most enormous travesty of disaster is going on right here. They've basically killed this entire area of seagrass by dumping spoil and digging a whole place up, removing the mangroves to turn into this megaport. If you've flown over it, it's absolutely mind-boggling. Well, where's the effect of that going to be? It's just going to slowly work its way down. So in 5 years, Bundy might hit it. 100 years, maybe Harvey Bay, 300 years, it might hit us. I don't know. It's totally speculation. But the point is that all these things are flowing on. The connectedness between the reefs and the mangroves, the mangroves and the seagrass, all of these things have evolved over millions of years from way up there. They've all come down together. When the mangroves arrived, they arrived in an environment where it was already set up with all these other things. So when you take one or two things out of it, God knows what happens. Here, these are some of the different habitats we have. So nice, clean, sandy bottoms, sort of fringing mangroves around this sort of area, shallow seagrass, really shallow seagrass. And along here, there's some overhangs and wharfs and things like that, some slightly different habitat. For me, the best place to dive is at the mouth, because that's where the clearest water is. And all of those species that are arriving in the Noosa River, they got to hit here first. So the species that we find here aren't necessarily in the rest of the river, but they're species that are making it at least this far south. So if we provide the right habitat and the right environmental conditions for them to survive, then they will be resources that we can tax later on. So here's what it looks like. This is just beyond where that previous arrow was. There's a sandbar just off the end there. And that sand is being constantly stirred up. And that's the first thing you're going to see. When you jump in at that point, it's just a sandstorm for about a minute. You can't see anything. It's completely zero vis. And you'll see here sand settling all on the camera. And that sand is settling all along there. And this bar is moving constantly. The rock wall, remember, has only been there for 30-something years. So this whole thing is in constant flux because of all the sand moving. And at this point, you're just like, why the hell am I here? I can't see anything. And that guy in the car park was just talking about bull sharks. And this sucks. And then suddenly, it just comes all clear, and you step out of this sandstorm, and you're in beautiful Noosa at its best. So this is looking back at the sandstorm. That's what you just swim through. And now we're going to go through a dive. This is, again, the best of all of the dives at the mouth. In that sandstorm, there's also all this weed, and this is coming from Laguna Bay and National Park. When it breaks off, all the weed breaks off there, and it comes into the river, and it's the first step of all of this productivity for all these brim. These are the juvenile crested morwongs, beautiful little fellas, about this big. I've only seen them once at that size as a school. But that's the start of the food chain. They're eating all the stuff, not just the algae that's coming in, but all the little micro critters that are living on the algae. So that's what they're doing. All these little bounces down to eat sand. And here's the flatties. This is a big female flathead. And at the back of each of these sand ripples, and they're all the way along there, there should be 10 or 20 or 30 or 50 flatties. I don't know, but there's still a few. At the top of the tide, the jew come out and head out to sea. And they go around me if I'm sitting at the base of the rock wall, but otherwise they hug the wall and just creep along there. So I'm not sure where they're going. But this is the drift along, and the flathead just explode out of the sand because you don't see them until you're on top of them, and then they get freaked out and they come out from underneath you. But the way they're feeding is just laying in those holes as I was talking about, and they're waiting for this bloke, little whiting, to come past. And that's, you know, they're an ambush predator. They're not out actively hunting. They're sitting there waiting, which means that fish has to come within the strike zone. This is back in July, about halfway down the wall, the current slows right down and the big fish accumulation happens. So in July, it's the lutterick or the black brim or blackfish, Jarella. And then sometimes that time of the tide is early morning, and that's when the jew are feeding, so that's the jew. And all these trevally, they're up feeding on the rocks hunting, and that's when it's a good time for the big gropers to be down in the deeper water looking up, waiting for all these small bait fish to get chased down. So it's a really fluid and active system. This is just a bit later in the tide where the current slowed down, they've all stopped feeding, and the jew make their way back down. There's a spot down the back there that they like to sit. Just off out in the deeper water, you got the barracuda, and these are big old guys, about this big. They're always there. It's a jello or pick-handled barracuda. Interesting, they've got a yellow tail. It's the only species of barracuda that does, and they're in the river. And there's a lot of river fish that have a yellow tail. So there's something about a yellow tail that works well for estuaries. I don't know what it is. Again, here's the kale moving up. They're not hunting at the moment. They were probably hunting earlier in the morning. And then you get to this patch where there's a cleaning station. We saw the cleaner wrasses earlier on. That's what this big guy was in there for. And that's around this area. You see a lot of different fish, a lot of small snappers. A lot of damselfish, these abiduftas. And this guy just popped. Who the hell is this guy? Does anyone know? Is this guy here? Is he here? No? I don't know who that guy was, but I just thought you might like the shock as much as I did. And then coming around the corner, you get into almost the eddy zone, and that's where the jew like to hang out. And this is that big whiting again. He's just cruising up and down the wall. Not too scared of jew. And then once you come around the corner, this is where all that weed that was coming in at the very mouth, that all accumulates. So in behind the rocks, you get these eddies, and eventually that's where it settles. And that's where most of the productivity is happening. The flatheads sit on the edge of that. So you see these huge mats of it, huge fields of it. And you can't see it very well, but there's brim and biddies and stuff chewing all over that stuff. Blue swimmer, sand crab, getting jiggy with his lady friend. Sorry, buddy. She was buried, I didn't know she was there. Swimming away, there's a flathead, there's his eyes there and there. So that's how they sit on the edge of these weed beds, just waiting for the biddies and brim to come close enough. And then occasionally, right up in the shallows, you get these spawning aggregations of the weeping todos, little puffers, that probably quite important. And then right at the very end, right up in the shallows, you get all these oysters covered in silt and sand that from the council's most recent dump of sand onto there. So between that and one other site that you showed you earlier, we've found so far nearly 180 species, about 300 in the wider Sunshine Coast area, and over 1,000 all up in Queensland. These are Liz's photos. Liz jumps in a couple of times as well. She takes stills. Okay, but the Noosa is more than a species list. We need to understand everything from egg right through to senescence, which is when they get too old to have babies. Who knows what this is? But that's a sinker for scale. So this is a very small, it's a Moses perch. That's a Moses perch. It's the same thing. So the question becomes, why the hell does this fish that starts out as transparent go to brown stripes, go to another one, which I'll show you in a second, then into this, which is the intermediate phase. This is under DPI jetty again. And then when they move offshore, they're silver. Why do they go through all these changes? Because it helps them evolutionarily. This has been decided that if you look just like this guy, you'll get through that big to that big. It'll increase your chances of survival to get to that size. It only works to that size because the guy you're mimicking only gets that big. So this is Cook's cardinal fish. He lives in these little caves and crevices like this guy is trying to hide out in. So there he is there. And yes, I'm just one of those little cardinal fish. Thanks, don't worry about me. I'm just sitting here totally harmless and careful, and I'm just eating until I get big enough to be something else. It's incredible that this happens, but when you throw in a million eggs and sperm on a good spawning and infinite variation, it's inevitable if you have enough generations that this kind of stuff happens, and it baffles me every time, but I love it. So the next step is this one. So why does it go from the brown stripes to the yellow stripes? Well, that's because, as I said, the cardinals only get that big, so you've got to grow out of those pajamas. The next size class that you want to blend in with in the Noosa River is this guy, the genus Fulvi flammer. So you see the yellow stripes, the black spot. Now these, side by side, I'm shooting these, you know, with bright lights in clear water with a bit of colour correction, so they look better than they actually do. But if you imagine that in sort of shifty visibility, a bit dark, not very clear, that and that are identical. So they can increase their chances of survival, of getting through those early stages of life, and that's when the real damage gets done, by the presence of these seemingly useless and unimportant species. So why does every species matter? Why does this useless little species matter? Well, because he's going to give the Moses perch a much better chance of getting up to adulthood, and that's good for the river. So what sort of critters are we talking about? Here are all those Moses perch again, and the smaller ones have still got the yellow stripe because they're blending in with the smaller snapper, which is Fulvi flammer that we just saw there. Okay, tiny Fulvi flammer, they follow brim around. So when the brim are feeding, the tiny Fulvi flammers like to get in there and, oh, yeah, there's something I can eat. And they're protected by being with this big guy. No one's going to mess with little fish while the big guy is there. There's a whole pile of tiny things going on that we don't even really see or give any credit. Nudibranchs are out, colourful, they're out during the day, but at night there'd be all kinds of snails and crabs and things walking around and clearing up a lot of this crap that's all over the bottom and turning over the nutrients. This is a mantis shrimp. Again, really well camouflaged, so he can come out during the day, but not something you typically see. Tiny gobies, so this patch of sand, that's his spot, and he's going to take mouthfuls of that sand and filter it through his gills all day. So that little patch of sand is going to be as clean can be. Should be millions of them. Blenny, this blenny needs this oyster, but he also needs the oyster cracker that came in and opened it for him so that he can move in there, and all these little spots here are actually his eggs. You see him on the back here. I spent a whole dive filming this little guy. Didn't get really the shots I wanted, but he's there. That's under the DPI jetty as well. The puffers, they're doing really well in the river. Why? Because they're poisonous and nobody eats them, is my suggestion. I don't know if that's right or not, but here's a few species. Porcupine, yellow boxfish. These are all completely toxic. No one, including fish, will eat them. Obviously, something eats them or else there'd be a billion of them, and there's not that many, but there are certainly a higher proportion than I would have expected. There's another species, there's a little female, male getting a bit horny there, puffing up his belly. These are black-saddled tobies, again, another species of pufferfish. Two puffers there. These are also, especially the erothrons, these guys, the real short little fat ones, they feed on all of that discarded bait that you see lying around, so that's probably why they're doing so well. Silver biddies, unsung heroes, same with the crested morwongs. This is the really early juvenile, but even at that age, and this is the adult, look at him taking your mouthfuls of sand and watch all the silt coming out the top here. Okay, with every mouthful, extrapolate that over, you know, a million fish doing it 24 hours a day over a huge scale, things are way different to the way they should be. Okay, little butterfly fish, juveniles. This is a display, this is a freaking out pose that butterfly fish do. All of his dorsal spines are fully extended. So something's going on. This guy, look out. This is a gudgeon. I'd never seen a gudgeon before I came to the Noosa River, so I was very excited about it. Okay, flathead. We're all talking about flathead. Well, this is a species that probably none of you have caught. It's called a fringe-eyed. It's got these bits sticking out the top. They sit in the weed. This is the usual one, the dusky flathead, which we saw earlier, waiting for a fish to swim about here. Any higher than that, and he's got no chance of getting it. So he needs either a lot of whiting to be passing just overhead, or biddies or something else, or he needs some other predator to chase all of those bait fish down to the bottom. Okay, so here's what he's hoping for, whiting. Just think of how many whiting would have been in this river 200 years ago. Yeah, it would just be billions crawling over the place, you would imagine. Okay, on the structures itself, there's a false stonefish here. Structure is where a lot of the fish are hanging out, not all of them. Some of them are just based purely on the sand, like the flathead and whiting, they're sand species. But the ones that need structure is a stonefish, smack bang in the middle of this shot. And it's hard to see, but that's his mouth there, and his eye is there and there. And all of these guys can see him. That's the important thing. They're all looking at him. Small wrasses like this would be the perfect food for him because they're looking at the bottom. They wouldn't even recognize that he's there, and he scoffs them. So we need a lot of these. This is another type of wrasse, Kerner's wrasse. We need a lot of these little wrasses buzzing around because I don't know how many it takes to feed a stonefish for a day, but it's probably a few. Juvenile surgeon fish. As adults, these guys get up in the schools of trevallies and eat their poo, but as juveniles, they're down herbivores, eating all the algae off the bottom. And that's what all these guys are too. It's a mixed school. There's rabbit fish, surgeon fish, and probably a few others in there as well. Again, back at DPI. And when you get a structure like this that's been there for a little while, it attracts just enough fish that at some point, cleaners move in. So I talked about the cleaners before being the cleaner wrasse. That's a common one you'll see in a second. But this was a discovery I didn't know about. These ones I know about. These are longfin banner fish. They're cleaners as well. But this, I was very surprised to see. These are the brim. You can see when the brim are hanging head down like that, that's I'm here to be cleaned. Come and clean me. All fish do this. So that's a really specific pose, and you cannot really see it in this shot. But what's cleaning them is actually the juvenile butter brim. And I had no idea. No one has recorded that as far as I know. But out of the mouth, butter brim feeding on plankton. As juveniles further in the river, they're cleaning brim of parasites. Incredibly important role. And how many people have given half a thought to butter brim? You know, I would say, apart from using them as bait, not many. Okay, so here's the typical cleaner. This is the cleaner wrasse. And this is back at the rock wall now. The kale coming in. See, all these fins are fully extended. And that's saying, I'm no threat. Come and clean me. I'm filthy with parasites. And the cleaner wrasse has gone back down now, but he knows what that means. There are more active hunters. This is a lionfish, which is a native here that does what it's supposed to do here in the Caribbean. They've been introduced and they're absolutely decimating the place. So they've got a bounty on them. They're actually apparently good eating too, and they've started a whole trend, business there eating these things. But the more typical predators, what you're all thinking of when you go fishing for predators, this is where you need lots of them. You know, a whole pile of fish swimming randomly in any direction, that's what you need if you're a predator. Well, the other thing that's really useful is to get them really balled up first. And you'll see that happen in just a second. But basically, predators can't work on their own. You know, this guy comes past, all these bait fish head to the back to the protection of the reef. One fish on his own, he might have, you know, one out of 20 successful runs. Whereas when you see them working together, it's just constant mayhem and carnage. Different fish coming in different directions. And this guy is the hero of it all. This is a cormorant. And he's the only one I've seen that managed to ball up the butter brim. This is a butter brim. A huge school spread over like twice the size of this room. They get them into this tight ball, and then they can just keep cutting through them and trying to catch stuff. But at the same time, see there he goes. At the same time he's got them balled up, that makes it possible for the amberjack to get them because now they're in a tight ball that he can actually work with. So you know, fishermen would always say, oh, cormorants, good for bloody nothing. You catch them sometimes, they tangle up, and what's the good of them? They chase the fish away. Well, actually, they're the reason, probably, that little section of wall is working well on those days. What's that spooge? Spooge is a made-up word. It doesn't exist, but it's referring to all this brown gunk crap all over everything. And in estuaries, mangrove systems, you expect silt. Silt is normal and natural, but I'm not 100% convinced that the silt that we have here is 100% healthy and natural. And if you're going to do some important research into the health of the river, rather than monitoring what the rainfall was, you're much better off, I think, doing some samples of all this silt, take core samples of each of the lakes, and get some serious information about what silt should be here and what silt is actually here. And we may find that this stuff is laced with God knows what chemicals or whatever, and maybe that's why there's not as much stuff growing on these rocks as I would expect. So I've got this little experiment running with just a couple of particular rocks on each of the dive sites where I just dust off with a dustpan just to get rid of all of the dust off it. And you'll see the shot in a second that I shot of this after I cleaned it. It's just all oysters under there, but they're buried under, you know, a lot of stuff. So I'm just wondering if maybe you know, maybe next year, years after, if that patch that I cleaned, and that's it there, that's the area, you see here it's all still got spoogel over it, but look at all these oysters. They're all suffocating slightly, but I'm sure they're all fine. But the thing that you're not getting is new settlement on top of those because they won't settle on that algae, on that spooge. Okay, animals do clean that stuff. This is a feathermouth sea cucumber. I've only seen this guy once and not again. There should be billions of these things. The entire lake system should be covered in them, sea cucumbers. I don't know if they are or not, but this particular species, they grab handfuls, you can see there, throw it in the mouth. They're digesting anything that's digestible, and out the back end comes clean sand. So they're nature's vacuum cleaners, and it would be great if there was a lot more of them. Goatfish, small scale, but they're doing the same thing. Look at these little, on the end of his chin, he's got these two barbels. That's why they're called goatfish. See the yellow bits there? And they're just constantly brushing the bottom. He's not deliberately cleaning silt off anything. He's trying to suss out or chase out little shrimps and crabs and fish. And that's why these two other fish are following him everywhere he goes, because as he chases little things out, they get a bit of a free feed. So again, these two species do better when this guy's here. Every species matters. If these two, maybe none of these three species matter, I don't know. Think about goatfish, think back to the trevally. There's a species for every occasion. Okay, so there's probably 30 or 40 species of goatfish around this part of the world, or Queensland. Here's two species. These guys, the one you just saw, like the rocks and things, this is the dash dot, he's a sand specialist, buries his head in sand a lot. But both of them, once they get used, everyone gets used to there being a big camera there, each of these little snappers are there because of the goatfish. And if you just watch, if you just sort of sit back and watch the individual little movements, oops, someone just got one. Oh, bugger, we all missed it. But then the goatfish go back to feeding, and these guys just make a circle around them. Let's be as close to this guy as possible because he's going to chase out some food that we can catch. At night, these guys would be out catching their own stuff, but during the daytime, opportunistically, they will hitch a ride off the goatfish. This is the seagrass halfway between the mouth and Lake Wyber. We were out there last week or whenever it was, and I just dropped the camera just in, you know, knee-deep water. And all of this silt and sediment is potentially an issue. I don't know if it's normal or if it's a problem, but there's no doubt that anything that blocks sunlight onto seagrass is going to have a massive, massive impact on the productivity of this river system. Everybody always talks about fresh water comes through and flushes all the prawns out. What the fresh water's doing, yeah, it does flush all the prawns out, but what the prawns all need is vast fields of seagrass in really good nick. Time will tell if that's all good. I'm just going to keep blasting through here. I know some of you are already asleep. Just give the person next to you an elbow if you could, if they look a bit dozy. This is a problem that never gets any attention. Everyone's too busy bashing the commercial netters. But for me personally, I see a lot of really, really sad things down there, which I appreciate most people don't care about, but nevertheless, I can get up here and get on my soapbox and tell you all about it. Most of the lures just get snapped off, and they're a very limited problem, really, to the grand scheme of things. But a lot of times, it's like this. They're in mid-water. They get attached to other line that's been there for, you know, 20 years or whatever. And sometimes they're actively still fishing, like this one. Okay, watch how this thing moves. It even dodges algae as it comes through. See that? And any fish looking at that is just as good a bait as it was attached to a guy's hand, you know? There's also a lot of these things down there, but it's a completely separate issue that's, again, very easy to do something about. We can fix all of this stuff, by the way. This is not just problems that we need to get all upset about. This is absolutely every day, and it's no problem. I don't think that's a problem. That's pretty widely accepted that you cut the hook as close as you can to the fish if you can't get the hook out, and they'll spit that out. You see kids walking through the malls with bigger things hanging out of their face than that. A problem, though, puffer fish. You often see these guys and the catfish you're about to see. Because they're opportunistic and they're bottom feeders, they're feeding on the rubbish. Any bait that gets tagged or any hook that's still got bait on it when it gets busted off, these guys keep eating on it. So they hook themselves and then they just keep thrashing and thrashing until the hook comes free. But that's the sort of damage it does. Again, gang hooks, one hook in the fish, the other hooks are on the bottom. And that's what I find to be the worst. A single hook doesn't seem to be a massive problem. Okay, some other critters are particularly susceptible. This is my favorite. And he's actually got a big line right around here. It's not a good shot, and there's a ripping current, as you can see. But I've got a plan to catch this guy one of these days, and it'll be with a barbless hook, but see, just a little cut across the top there and he'd be free of that, no problem. And this was my saddest day, but actually it was kind of a good day in some ways because it really fired me up and got some shit done. I've been chasing cormorants that's what started this whole project, was to get some footage of cormorants feeding. And this guy I'd watched for an hour before I jumped in, waiting for the tide to settle down, sussing out exactly where he was. And an hour into the dive, I found him drowned. And it was just one little tiny hook through his foot. And because when you see them hunt, they go like this, like crazy with their feet. And he's just hooked a thing, and he would have flapped there until he drowned, struggling, and died. But anyway, this is a more common thing that you see. This is a deliberate thing. This is a brim that was still alive. He's got a hook through his back, and the reason he's doing so poorly is because he's also got a wire trace attached to that to gang hooks, which was attached to the bottom. So here's the whole rig. Gang hooks, hook through his back. So this is a fish legal size that could have been someone's breakfast, but instead they've put a hook through its back, thrown it back out there to catch a bigger fish, and, I mean, what a way to die. So this is ridiculous, I know, but he was all bent out of shape, so I massaged him and kept swimming with him for an hour or two, and he still died, but I don't know. I thought maybe he'd spring back to life or something if I swam him for a while. He's still breathing, but anyway. That's not what this is about. That's just a little bit of poor me. Okay, here's one that I think with a bit of time and effort and ingenuity, we could do something about. If they've got a swivel on the end, we could catch that. A couple of divers with the boat crew above that I'll talk about shortly. And I reckon we could have unhooked him. Unhook one fish, who gives a toss? But in the big picture, I think it does matter because it would make any film that you did about this, for example, it makes it interesting and watchable for other people. Every time we see something that's tangled like this, obviously we get rid of it, untangle it if we can. Liz was with me on this dive, so when you see me signalling, I was actually signalling to her. And I'll just talk you through what was going on here. This is kind of typical. It's every case is, how the hell do I deal with this? You know, it's completely separate. So in this case, he had three lines in different directions that he was tangled to. It was all different lines that he'd sort of wrapped himself around. He's got the hook in his lip, but then this one here is what I was worried about, thinking back to the other guy that you saw previously. So I was thinking I'll just cut him off, and then I thought, oh no, I could actually get this off. So I'm signalling to Liz now that I'm going to take him up to get a fisherman to help me unhook him. And while I'm figuring out which lines to cut to do that, he's gone into what morays very often do. Anyone who's caught one on a line has recognised this behaviour. They turn into a bloody big knot. And so now I'm reconsidering, because I thought back to, this is in Ambon, one of the most polluted fishing harbours in the world, in Indonesia, this is a couple of years ago. Exact same scenario. So he's had line, he's got it wrapped around himself here, and he's twisted up and just pulled on that line until it's cut right through to the spine, all the way around him, and that was enough that he could actually break the line. So that's my little man who's just done this big spin, and that's, yeah, obviously he's not going to survive. Well, he didn't survive. But obviously that's what this guy was heading for as well. He untangled himself briefly, and I thought, I just got to cut him off here. So there he goes. He's still got that hook in his bottom lip, but he doesn't have all the other hooks in line, so I'm pretty confident he'll be okay. Crabs are particularly susceptible. They're always walking around in this fishing line, obviously, and it's all over the place. A lot less of it now than there used to be, but there's still a heap of it there. Easy enough to untangle. It just takes a bit of time. This one had no nippers, so it was particularly easy jobby to get out. But all of the mouth parts of the crab were tangled up. So how long would this poor bugger have just sat there for? It would have been months probably before he finally starved to death. Pretty sad. And this is him just afterwards, cleaning up all these mouth parts. All this was tied shut. So he's just going, oh, thank God, I can move these around. And also, you'll see in the next shot, there's so much bait being discarded that with those mouth parts, that's a bit of bait that's just floating around down there. He'll be able to feed on that anyway. So I think he's probably going to survive. Bigger ones with bigger nippers, a bit more challenging to get off. Very ungrateful. Next time he's being cooked. And this is a very important thing. For anyone here that is a diver that's suddenly inspired and is going to get out there and clean fishing line, congratulations, I thoroughly applaud you, but please be very careful. There are stonefish everywhere. So this is him again, mouth, eye. And this particular guy hadn't bitten the hook, he just had it wrapped around his dorsal spine. So the line is this braid, which tangles worse than anything else, as far as I can tell. It's just twisted around, and then it's coming down and going up this way. So it's just a matter of getting it as close as I could without this deadly spines all along the back here. You see how it's caught up on it there? This isn't dangerous. What's dangerous is going around, feeling around on the bottom and not seeing the stonefish. But having said that, kids at home, don't try this. Here he goes, cut him off, and away he goes. So this is his little girlfriend or boyfriend about 2 metres away. There's the mouth, eye, looking straight at us. There he is again, under some fishing line. So that was the next clump that I was actually going for. And sure enough, I was alert to it because I just pulled one out. There's also stingrays, which are of no danger whatsoever. But they have a bit of trouble with all this because they like to bury in these little sand patches. And all of this sand, as you can see the line coming out, it's completely covered under there in fishing line. So as he tries to bury himself, and you see there, he's having trouble getting down. Eventually he does. But flathead do the same thing. They'll bury themselves down. Fine, they're not going to spike themselves or do any damage. But when they take that attack run, that's a mighty kick. And if there's any hook there, they just hook themselves by the tail. So it's a simple problem. Put the camera down and go and pick some stuff up. So that's what we do now. Every dive, we spend at least probably half the time collecting line. And this is how it's got to be done. It's a very slow process. You got to take handfuls and lift directly up and cut individual lines and go bit by bit. It's an absolute spider web. As soon as you pull one, you've got dozens of others. Okay, so I'll just let this run for a bit. And has anybody spotted the stonefish yet in this shot? Okay. Yeah, okay. If you haven't, there's his eye. And this is the mouth here. A bit of algae just obscures. You can still see his eye through the algae there. But you're going to get a tip-off very soon of the crested morwong. And just watch his behaviour when he goes, "Hey, everyone, look at this guy. It's a stonefish." But this is, in the background, you can see what's going on. And this is one of the dangers. I hear a lot of the local blokes going out, the young fellas going out collecting lures. It's absolutely the best place to get lures in town. Check it out. Like, there's millions of them, and they're free. But the danger is when you start doing this, and those guys aren't doing this, by the way, they're just taking the lures, which is good. When you start wrapping bundles of the stuff around your hand, you've actually got a hand full of hooks, like absolutely chockers. They're not sticking into you yet, but you can feel that they're there. And the real danger here is people doing this on snorkel, you dive down, you think you're all cool, but as soon as a boat goes past, there's an unexpected boat wake, which moves you up and down really short and sharp. That hook's in your hand. Panic, boom, you are a dead cormorant within however long you can hold your breath. Seriously, it's that quick. So there's that stonefish again. So anyone who does want to get into this, by all means do it on scuba. Be really careful of stonefish. They are absolutely everywhere. And if you are doing it while filming, accept that half the time when you're collecting stuff, there's really cool stuff happening right in front of you that you're missing. So it's, quick camera. And this is the shot. I actually didn't get this. This is the shot I was trying to get, but I missed it and I got him the next time around. But anyway, big old amberjack cruising through. And that's because the cormorant was chasing these guys up and down the wall. That's what I was actually waiting for. Okay, so it is a horrible problem, but it's very easily doable. Just fix it, just get in there and sort it out. And it's certainly not a Noosa problem. Just one bit of food for thought on this. Since 1940, we've been using monofilament line. Every single person who's been snagged or busted off since then on the Queensland coast, that line is still down there somewhere. So that's a shitload of fishing line. Just find out how much the guys have sold in the local shops, and that's how much of it is out there. Okay, so these are all the areas I'd really like to hit. Again, I've done here really thoroughly, well, reasonably thoroughly, and where is it? Probably about here somewhere really reasonably thoroughly. But all of these other areas, that's where the important stuff is. And it's much harder to film because the visibility gets worse the further away from here you get. So this method that I've been using today isn't going to work. We need to get a bit more serious about it. So I need a boat. I'm not here asking for donations, by the way. This is the big picture of what we're heading towards. And if you'd like to get involved, we could certainly use the help. A 5.8 metre, 19 foot boat is what I've figured is the perfect thing. One of those catamarans, I'll show you in a second. It's got to be easily launched on site, highly manoeuvrable, shallow draft, zero noise. Easy to get in and out with this thing, which weighs 26 kilos, and we could use additional boats once we get the whole program up and running and have a decent amount of divers. But this is what it would look like. This is my other camera. I've got two of these things. So the other one will be on a boom shooting, so we can be going over those really shallow, vast areas. We can be shooting from above water, even though the camera's underwater. That's the monitor, so you can watch remotely. These boats cost between $2,000 and $4,000, depending on what sort of condition you get them in. This is the outboard, the electric, latest and greatest, 112 pounds of thrust. If you look out on the river, most of the guys who know what they're doing in boats have got one of these on the front. And the reason none of them are complaining that there's no fish in the river just yet is because they're using these as well. And with this, you can see every single stick. That's probably a plastic bag stuck to one of the branches. There's tiny shots here, it probably won't show up, but you can see individual fish this big. So the guys going down along John's Landing with their tinnies and this, and that previous motor I told you about, you can press a button on here and say, yeah, put me there. And this thing will go and just hover you there in any conditions, no matter what the current's doing, wind, whatever, hold you exactly there, and you can just keep flicking your lure at that snag until you get that fish that's sitting right there. Like, it's that simple these days. This technology is only getting better, and it's about time we started using it for good instead of evil. We can start tracking fish with it. So you imagine that, if I had a guy, girl, someone, up on the boat above with that view. Imagine there would be a diver sitting here. I spoke to Phipsy the other day, and he said he's using similar gear, and he could clearly see the bull sharks on his stuff. So you'd see a diver swimming here, and the guys could say, yeah, you've got a bull shark coming up on your right, turn right. Comms, so this is a full face mask with a microphone in it and a speaker, and then the guys up on the boat can talk to you. And you could see stingrays in the shallows, you can see birds hunting and feeding, all kinds of stuff that I can't see from underwater with my limited visibility. So that's how we're going to get the rest of the species. This is the important stuff, getting rid of fishing line, untangling oysters and crabs and other things, removing plastic. The crab pots I was talking about, when we went for this cruise last week, we saw probably 30 or 40 of them, various parts up and down the river. They're derelict, people have tied them on and lost them in bad visibility or whatever, but in good vis, you can see them crystal clear. And the natural thought is to go in there and grappling hook and pull them all out and clean the river up of these things, which is possibly the right thing to do. But my guess is more likely that these things have become habitats now, and the best thing to do with them would be actually to go down physically and cut them open so that nothing can get trapped in them, but anything that's already on it and using it as a habitat gets to keep doing that. Because one thing that we are losing in this river is habitat. Every time somebody wants a nicer view in front of their nice place and they remove a tree, or a tree falls down and the council says, oh, that's ugly, or someone complains and says, that's ugly, fishermen are getting snagged on it and it gets removed. That's really important habitat for the critters. This is the big picture stuff that I hope you take home from today. Biodiversity is the best indicator of environmental health, and anyone with a camera can record it. These little things, GoPros, latest ones, 4K, unbelievable. So all the shots you've seen of me were with a GoPro. It's like a $400 camera. If you put that in the right place, using the right conditions, anybody can shoot anything. So if you live opposite from water here, you got a jetty, get a GoPro, stick it underwater, and for God's sake, do some editing before you show the world. No one wants to see 16 hours of brim swimming under your jetty, but they do want to see 1 minute of tightly edited, look at all this amazing stuff that's under my jetty. So I encourage everyone to have a crack at it. And if you don't want to, just steal my stuff off the internet and do it with that. All marine habitats are intimately connected, and every species matters. You can't have reefs without seagrass, and vice versa. Always question the baseline bias and methods of fishing information. There's a lot of it floating around out there. And from my experience talking to everybody, you imagine walking down to the rock wall with this, full scuba gear, especially in winter, it's raining and you've got a dry suit on, you look like some sort of alien. It attracts a lot of attention, and everybody who's interested in fish comes and talks to me, and it's fairly uniform across the spread that recreational guys blame the commercial guys blame the recreational guys, and everybody blames council for the river mouth, Donella, Munna, and Doggy Beach. That's pretty much uniform, and they're all right, is the thing. So to blame any one group is a little bit pointless, but mainly the stuff you're hearing, you know, if it starts with, well, we were always told, or my granddad always said, it's bullshit, quite frankly, because granddad didn't know what we know today, and what granddad was fishing in was an untapped resource where, you know, a kid with a bucket could have caught a fish. Today, that is not the case. We know better than what we knew, and we need to be using that real information, the proper credible information based on facts and not whatever. Plastic is forever, so is monofilament line. Every species in the Noosa filmed in the river and anywhere else I go diving is available to view online for free. So go onto our website, search Fiji, you'll see a million shots of Fiji, blah, blah, blah. Any questions? That was it. I drew that picture. Did you see the picture? That took me ages to do that. Yep, nacras are the best. They're 5.8, so they're 19 foot, but they're flat bottomed. Hobie cats kick up, so the flatter the bottom, the more buoyancy you get per draft. Yep. Yeah, so just a small console from what that picture, there'd be a small console there with a cover over it. And most of what we'd be shooting actually would be, like the cameras here, we'd be shooting on tripod, shooting birds feeding from the surface, a lot of surface stuff. Yeah, I agree with you. But I mean, before I came here the first time, before I did anything, I went to both the fish shops, the big ones. There's Davo's and Hooked on Fishing, the two local big ones. And I told everyone in the shop that was interested, I showed them that, not this footage, but some footage. So this is what I'm doing. Like I'm doing here. Anyone interested, contact form is on the website. You know, anyone wants to get involved, you guys want to sponsor me, all that stuff. And that's where that ended, a year and a half ago. Everybody's interested, but nobody wants to fund it. And I'll spread it beyond reef balls to all artificial reefs. We definitely need more habitat, absolutely. Someone raised a really good point on this the other day that I hadn't considered before, and that was because there's been talk about putting a wreck offshore as well, and it's the same sort of topic. It's there for conservation purposes to attract more marine life. The wreck side of things, which isn't your question, I appreciate, that costs about $2 million to put that thing down and clean it. That, if you're doing it for conservation, you could do a hell of a lot more with $2 million for conservation. When it comes to reef balls and things, they're a hell of a lot cheaper than that. And there's also locally made ones, which are probably a better option in my opinion, because they're just because of the way they're built, the structure of them. But generally, that whole idea is a really good one, as far as I'm concerned, just to increase the habitat that we've got. One of the problems just off Laguna Bay there, and when I first moved here, the local dive scene was basically go diving at the rocks off National Park. And when I finally came time to do that, it was all on the sand. The sand moves so much there that it gets buried. So that happens fairly regularly. So my issue with reef balls would be that possibly they're too low and they might suffer the same thing. You're better off getting something higher up so that it creates more habitat for a start. You're up into the more better lit zones. Also has all the same benefits that those do.
Reef balls on a stick.
Reef ball on a stick? Better work. Species in the Noosa River. So we can give two species to every shooting fish in this river until I'm dead. So anytime anyone comes along who wants to do something with us, it's there. You can help yourself for free, or if you can do, if you want to do something bigger and actually support this work, then raise the money however you do it and call us in, and here we are, ready to help.
Okay, I think on that note, you'll be a little while packing up your kids, so you can probably ask a couple of questions afterwards. But wow, I really enjoyed your virtual this earlier in the year, and this one's trumped it.
Thank you.
Thank you very, very much.
Thanks everyone for coming.